Lecture 7 is a one that is a little more difficult than the others, and this is where things for the rest of the semester are become a little more difficult for every lecture, every quiz. So this is where the game has to be stepped up a little bit more. So make sure you spend a little extra time on these next quizzes because they're the ones that generally give people the most trouble. As far as the questions go, this one's a little more difficult because you've got questions all over the place. And when I mean all over the place, I mean you've just got one on this concept, one on this, one on this, one on this. And they don't seem to have some continuity to them, but that's because you have to learn the laws of thermodynamics. You have to learn some of the basics to be able to understand how it applies to biology. So let me just kind of walk you through them. Everyone will have one on the first and second law of thermodynamics. And I say one on either one of these laws. So make sure you know how to define these laws, but also make sure you know how they work, right? Because that's not the only definition of the law of entropy. All energy transformations are inefficient. There's other definitions of entropy. Things going from a highly ordered to a disordered state. Things going from a high concentration to a low concentration. All of those are definitions and descriptions of how entropy works. This is the definition, but there are so many applications of it. And this is going to be one of those critical ones that keeps coming up throughout the semester. So you've got to make sure you know entropy really well. So one question on either one or both. Some questions include both in terms of how I'm asking the question. As far as chemical reactions go, make sure you know endergonic, exergonic, and coupled. It could either be on one or the other or both together. Okay, so make sure you know each one of these. Again, endergonic are dehydration synthesis reactions, and exergonic are hydrolysis reactions. We've talked about dehydration synthesis and hydrolysis before, but make sure you understand that connection between them, that one is an energy absorption, that's dehydration synthesis, and one is energy release, that's hydrolysis, okay? And then when you put the two together, it basically looks like this. One releases energy, one absorbs the energy, then it releases the energy and absorbs. Notice again, because of entropy, energy is lost in the energy transfer, which is why we can never fully recycle all the energy in our bodies because of that. ATP is another one that comes up. Make sure you know that the energy is in the covalent bonds between the phosphates. Wrong answers are between phosphate and sugar, or in the sugar, or between the sugar and the base. It's between the phosphates because of the destabilization of the covalent bond due to the ionic charge of these phosphate groups, thus making this energy easily accessible. Okay? So make sure you understand why ATP is used as a battery biologically, because covalent bond energy is covalent bond energy, but these covalent bonds are easy to break and get the energy out of them. Enzymes is another one that you've got questions on. Make sure that you know what enzymes are, what they do. Again, they don't lower the potential energy or kinetic energy. They lower the amount of energy. That's what energy of activation energy, I use them interchangeably. It's the same thing. It lowers the amount of energy, just like this fulcrum lever does to move this boulder. Okay? You can basically lower the amount of energy you have to expend to do the same job. That's what enzymes do. They have a very specific three-dimensional shape. They have an active site. They're not consumed in the process, just like this lever can be used over and over and over. The enzymes are not consumed in that. They just facilitate a environment that makes it easy for the covalent bond to either be put together or broken apart. And each enzyme, again, has a very specific function based upon its shape. Also, make sure that you understand how you can actually inactivate an enzyme, not by denaturing it, but by blocking that active site. There will be a question on the quiz regarding why cyanide kills us and penicillin doesn't, or why penicillin kills bacteria and cyanide doesn't. And that comes down to, again, what enzymes we have in our cells. Penicillin doesn't block any enzyme in our body, and so it's not going to hurt us. Cyanide will, a very important enzyme in your mitochondria, and that's what will kill you. But vice versa. penicillin will absolutely kill bacteria because they block that enzyme that's needed for them to produce their cell wall. So make sure you understand enzyme inhibition, because it's going to come up later when we talk about cancer. That's what chemotherapy is, right? And so we're going to discuss this later, which is why I want you to be familiar with it now. Now, one other question that you're going to have comes down to potential energy. And this actually goes back to a previous lecture when we were discussing the organic molecules. Remember the monomers and the polymers? Polymers, again, are long chains of monomers. And I'm going to refer back to lecture 5, so make sure you go back to those notes, and ask you which of the following molecules has the most potential energy. Well, again, this is the application. Potential energy is covalent bond energy. If you have a triglyceride, which is lots and lots of covalent bonds, and you have a glucose molecule, which is a single carbon ring structure of a carbohydrate, which one has more energy? The triglyceride. Why? Because it's a polymer. It's bigger. It has more covalent bonds. So in that question, it'll actually be very similar to the previous one in that I'll give you a polymer and four monomers. Or if I say which one has the least potential energy, I'll give you a monomer and I'll give you four polymers. That way it's very clear cut which one has the least amount of energy. You don't have to go counting the covalent bonds and looking it up. Just need to understand that the bigger the molecule, the more covalent bonds it has, the more energy it has. And that's the whole point of this, is to understand that covalent bonds are biological energy. And that's what we use. And this is where we're going to with photosynthesis and glucose metabolism, is that we're converting kinetic energy into covalent bond energy through photosynthesis. That's what plants do. We eat them, and then we convert that kinetic or potential energy, which is covalent bonds, the food, back into kinetic and then back to potential and so on and so forth. So that's the idea behind all of this. Now, that's the first half of your quiz. The second half of your quiz is on membrane transport. This one's a little simpler because they all kind of have a general outline as to what their jobs are. It's a little, doesn't go all over the place like the first half does. But these six concepts, simple diffusion, facilitated diffusion, osmosis, active transport, and then the two bulk transport, exocytosis and endocytosis. Those are the possible answers. In reality, it's everything but osmosis, because osmosis has its own question amongst the five. So make sure you know the examples that we talked about, because those are the examples I'm going to use for the quiz. The only one that's different is the osmosis question. The answers will be isotonic, hypotonic, and hypertonic. This is the one usually people mess up on. So use these pictures to help you to remember that when a cell is in a hypotonic solution, it means that the solute concentration on the outside is less. That's what hypo means, which means there's more water, which means water flows in. That's osmosis. Water goes where it's lowest. It'll go from high to low, just like any other molecule. Hypertonic means a high solute concentration in the water, and therefore less water. So guess what? Water comes out of the cell because there's more water in the cell than on the outside. The cell shrivels up. Same thing with plants. Hypo, they love it because of their cell wall. They won't burst. Hyper, they hate it. That's when you know you need to water your plants more, because water is actually leaking out. It's not coming into the cells. You need to saturate the soil and their cells with water. They like the hypotonic surroundings. All the other modes, though, active transport, exocytosis, endocytosis, those will be the answers for the multiple choice questions. Make sure you know the examples that I gave in class. Those are the ones I typically use to describe these forms of transport across the membrane. So the last five questions of your quiz will be on these six concepts, and that will finish lecture 7 for you.